morning, Pio Nation. I hope you're doing well today. My name is Matt Williamson.
My name is Zachary Simpkins.
And you are watching Marietta College Esports. So we have our Smash team. They are going to be playing their last GLEC match of the fall 2023 season. And they're starting a little bit early, which is why we are starting up the stream a little bit early. They're going to be going up against University of St. Francis in this 3v3 crew battle. Since we are getting the lobby set up already, we're just going to try to run through our announcements before they get started. So first of all, let's talk about who's going to be playing today. And honestly, I don't know who's playing today. All I know for sure is that starting off will be sophomore Peyton Engel Ginger Ale. I believe we will also have sophomore Mason Rice Cheshire playing and junior Aether McDonald Inava playing. But we'll have to see how things go. But yeah, we'll see who's playing. So we'll let you know once things get started off here. But we also want to give a shout out to our head coach, Derek Games Grum. But we're going to go and try to fly through some announcements because it looks like St. Francis is already in the lobby too. So first, we want to give a shout out to HyperX for being the official peripheral sponsor of Marietta College Esports. They have provided our facility with keyboards, mice, headsets, mouse pads, and microphones. Our students love the quality. We're using their QuadX mic in our broadcasting room. So if you want to check out HyperX and the peripherals they have available, please be sure to go to hyperx.gg/MariettaES. The QR code is up on your screen for a few more seconds. We also want to give a shout out to Over the Moon Pizza for their support. Every Tuesday and Thursday, they have their game night at their restaurant in Front Street, where you can play. They have a Nintendo Switch where you can play some Super Smash Brothers or some Mario Kart or Mario Party. And on Tuesdays, they will be showcasing the matches that we stream. So, of course, we have Overwatch that plays on Tuesdays. They are right now 4-0 in the NA Star League Varsity Plus. So you can go there next Tuesday at 7 o'clock Eastern time and cheer on as our Overwatch team plays again and see if they can continue their undefeated streak.
So you definitely want to go there Tuesday if you want to watch a W.
Mm-hmm. We just want to thank everyone for your support. Thank you for your follows. Thank you for your subscriptions. It is one of the main ways that we generate revenue to help provide support for our students. So by subscribing to our channel, of course, you get the emotes that you see on your screen. Now, of course, there is Prime Gaming, so if you have an Amazon Prime account, you can connect your Twitch account to your Amazon Prime account to give you Prime Gaming, which gives you perks, including a free sub. And we're getting started off here, and St. Francis actually chose random.
They did.
And so, it's going to be Greninja, so an interesting choice here.
That's interesting. So we have Greninja versus Corrin here.
Yeah, so Ginger Ale will be starting off with on the Corrin. I'm going to try to get the volume up a little bit. It seems a little quiet, at least on my end. So hopefully that's a little bit louder for you guys.
Okay.
So, let me check here.
This is maybe a lag test. I think at the moment they might be doing a latency test because I really noticed.
Oh, I think you're right. Yeah. Yeah, this is it's a latency test.
So they're that or maybe they're just like really.
No, it's a latency test. Other teams have done this before. So I'm going to check the audio on the other stream real quick. I'll be right back.
Gotcha. Yeah. Latency test over now. I hope that everything's working just fine for them. Yeah, I was gonna say, usually you don't random in a competitive setting, so.
Okay, how's that? Does that sound a little better?
Yeah.
But, okay, so that was the latency test. All right, I tried to up the audio a little bit so it's a bit more to hear, better to hear. But all right, now the only thing about that is now St. Francis kind of is going to guess that they're going to start with Corrin, so that might give them a little bit of an advantage of who they want to pick against it.
Yeah, I guess that is like the benefit of choosing random there for the latency test instead of choosing your actual character. But honestly, you still have the same game plan. One of the things that at least I use in Overwatch is, yes, other teams like will have like a certain composition or certain character that they play that you might want to try to play around, that honestly, it's simply better if you just play your own game and play your game better than they play their game. So even if, like, they find that, oh, they're playing Corrin, like, there's no point in swapping off Corrin or trying to mix it up. Just play Corrin the best you can and just try to do better than their whatever they want to play.
Alright. Still trying to up the audio a little bit, so that should be at least a bit better to hear on the screen.
Yeah,
actually, it might be too much now that I look at it. Let me press this back down a little bit. Alright. I think that should be pretty reasonable.
Pretty good.
Alright, it looks like they are going to be playing Pokemon Stadium 2.
I love Pokemon Stadium. I've said it before. Pokemon Stadium is such a... it's such an ancient map, but I guess it did get revamped to be a little bit more fair, but in Melee, it was so much fun to watch in Melee because it was a legal stadium with a weird map change with, like, lift up, and there you could do some stupid combos where you could 100-0 someone and instantly erase them, and just, it was so cool. Mm-hmm. And we're gonna see Aroy up against Corrin. See, Corrin is a little bit more favored in this matchup because she has the better range, and Roy has, I believe, a worse recovery. So
right.
We're gonna see how Corrin is gonna be able to deal with this Roy.
If she can keep the distance, because Roy does hit hard from that close range.
The one thing with Roy, though, is that he has very early kill potential with his side smashes. Oh, dash attack.
Another dodge. Great kick.
That's a good kick there, but he didn't actually get it because of the recovery frames. He's not really at enough percentage to be able to use those kicks without getting punished. Oh, that almost broke his shield. One more of those, and that's definitely going to be it. 71% on the coin here. Oh, that's really good. That's stun, but doesn't quite get the bite they're looking for. Oh, that's a good aerial there. They aren't quite able to get anything off of it. It's going to be a dash attack, putting them to 68%. 86%, mind you. Up to 96. She's in kill percentage at the moment. One side smash from Roy, and they're very fast. That could be it. Oh, that could have been punishable, but... believe they're just not ready for it. Ginger Ale. Oh, that's some big damage. 62%. Now he's off the map. This could be where.
Tries to go for the stun.
Doesn't quite go for that edge guard. Again, you have to play very safe here. There's that side smash, as you can see.
Okay, Roy was trying to predict the counter there.
Ooh, that's a good hit. Okay, they tried to spot dodge, but still got it. They had to shield it anyways. 91%. Again, MC Esports putting up a great fight here. That's good. That's
there
a
solid
we go. Right off the map.
That's what you want to see.
There we go. Oh, already a good percentage there, but the get-up attack is going to stop any more aggression. And there's that side smash evening the odds. And now we're back at 0-0 with Marietta and UFC. Let's get that counter. But you see, Corrin's counter is bad. Compared to other counters. Like, Roy's counter is way better. There's some combos this Roy has versus fastballs.
Oh! Oh, you didn't see that.
That's unfortunate. And, yep, only have so many invincibility frames there. Try to get an up tilt. Doesn't quite get it. Stops that side B. And again. Getting hit 30 to 45%, but Marietta has to come back now because they did lose that stock to the unfortunate SD, and they did
and
it again.
Just the missed input there of going too far, so Ginger Ale is going to be out. So it looks like Cheshire is going to be coming in.
Two SDs is very unfortunate. That was very winnable.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Ginger Ale was doing very well there, but it's just... yeah, it's going to be... actually, it's not going to be Cheshire. They're going to talk things over. They're trying to decide who's going to play next.
Yeah, but just that last round, we saw that Roy was actually slightly struggling with being able to get in touch with the Corrin just because of that range and the... the threat of the different spikes that the different side B that she has and able to kick in multiple different directions. He was having a harder time punishing that and couldn't really get a side smash off until, you know, he got invincibility frames and was able to do it. But yeah, those two SDs are just going to be monumental if in this first round. If Marietta does lose this first round, I'm pretty sure it's going to be just by two stocks with just by seeing that one player play.
Okay. So I think Chessfire was giving some of the other team members a chance to play, but I think they're going to let Chessfire come in. He's going to be bringing in the Game & Watch.
He has been on that Game & Watch grind. I do remember that. Again, I personally like it whenever he plays Donkey Kong, but I'll settle for some Game & Watch. Just like, that's for me, I love watching Game & Watch. He does have a little bit of a boring playstyle, but I just think it's so specific and so like micro heavy. You have to always be having an aerial out. You always have to be doing an up air, a forward air, and also you have to be doing the combos on the ground while also keeping the pressure the entire time. It's just one of those things, like, if you see a good Game & Watch play, it's so hard to get in on him because he's making, like, a wall of just combo potential. Mm-hmm. If you get hit by a bomb, you're going to get hit by the fishbowl, and if you get hit by the fishbowl, you're getting hit by the turtle, and if you get hit by the turtle, then you're off the map, and that's off the stage.
Mm-hmm. I know he likes doing the aerial bomb combo, mm-hmm. So we'll see if he can pull that off in here. It looks like it's going to be small battlefield for the map. Or maybe not? No, looks like they're going to go back to Pokemon Stadium 2. I mean, we were talking before about how popular this is, and sometimes for matches they do a gentleman's agreement with just Pokemon Stadium 2 for the entire series.
It's like, it's a really good map. Is why it has a good ceiling. It has no goofy ledges. The ledges are nice. There's no, like, weird thing underneath the stage that can really spike people that often. I mean, it's still there, but not to the extent of like other maps. Like, what am I trying to think? I think like Small Battlefield is actually one of those that have those weird angled things that are under the stage and are really annoying if you play up against someone like a Donkey Kong that can throw you off the side of it. But we're gonna see Game & Watch versus Roy. Now, the one downside of Game & Watch is that he is like a very lightweight. He can be easily one-shottable. And now they're off the races. There's that fishbowl I was talking about. There's the bombs. Oh, rolls right into the arms of Roy at 30% already. 27% on the Roy now. 39, that's pretty good. Going aggressive with those bombs, but gets rolled right into that jab. Spot dodge for Rob, keeps him safe from any pressure. Oh, doesn't pick up the jab there, it's on the other side of Rob. Now we're going to see the Game & Watch out there. But again, he gets hit by that jab.
Yeah,
65%. Weirdly enough, 65% is basically kill percentage, especially right now for Game & Watch, since he's such a lightweight. This is kill percentage for Roy. Oh, 100%. That was a good combo from Roy with that grab. He's able to get that grab into that up air. Oh, he does get the counter on the up air, but Game & Watch has projectile, so he's just trying to counter the projectile there. That's going to be a four tilt. Oh, that's a good pound, and that's going to be...
That's huge right there.
That's... I love it with Game & Watch. When you get those down smashes, you're able to get a guaranteed side smash. It does so much damage and so much knockdown. And that's going to be evening the odds, but again, because it is a crew battle, Marietta is at 5-7 at the moment.
Actually, St. Francis is up.
So, yeah. Because it's crew battle, Marietta is at 5.
Right.
Because of this, so yeah, there's even, but really, we wanted to see Cheshire take this with no stocks lost. But you have Wish in one hand and something in the other. Oh, that's going to be a jab. 55%, 62% is lying here. Marietta almost gets that side smash. Yeah, the Game & Watch's smash attacks are very fast comparatively to other players. Trying to get the close.
He's so close.
Have to be aware. And I see that there's really no hammer combos Cheshire are going for. That's one of those things you see Game & Watch go for a lot, is the side B, those hammers. If you get a 10, it will one-shot someone at 64%, basically. He's not really going for that essential part of Game & Watch's kit. Like, right there, you could have done a hammer instead of the down smash. But I guess Cheshire has just a different game plan. That was very close, 150%. He could be breathed on and go down. Roy knows this.
Oh, that's exactly what he needs without dropping other stock.
There we go. And Roy gets grounded and then gets hit out.
And that was, I mean, the whole time Cheshire was just one hit away from being knocked out, but just able to dodge all those attacks and getting that ground combo in to save him. That's going to be huge going into the next matchup, because now it's just a one-stock differential between the teams.
That will be amazing. So we're going to see if Cheshire can take his two stocks all the way. If he can get a good lead and stop the lead of St. Francis, I believe Marietta comes back into the game and is able to really get the ball rolling and snowball from this.
All right, so now St. Francis will get a chance to decide what map they want to pick and what character they want to go up against the game and watch. So we'll just have to wait a little bit for it. So while we're waiting for it, just to give a reminder on the schedule, so later today, our Fortnite team will be back, where they're going to be participating in the NACE Star League Zero Build Championship. They qualified for this like 2 weeks ago. And last week they had a very strong performance. So, I mean, I know they're really excited to be a part of it and possibly take a national title.
I would love to see it. I'm going to be here for it. Mm-hmm. I'm going to shout Cassie. Yeah. That's going to be an amazing game to watch and an amazing game to be able to shout Cassie. We're going to see our Fortnite team in Marietta, Ohio go up against the big leagues, up against Akron U, most likely up against these giant schools.
Mm-hmm. So. Yeah, it's going to be exciting. So that's going to be 3 o'clock Eastern time. They'll be playing 6 games, so please be sure to come back for that.
That's 2 more than usual. That's awesome.
Yeah, the championship is always 6 games.
Awesome.
Yeah, and then of course next week we're going to have quite a few matches. We got matches on Monday. Oh, Mithra Pyra.
Not a Pyra.
Okay.
No. Why? I hate watching this character.
Well, I got some bad news for you. You're going to have to watch this character.
I don't.
All right, so Chestar is going to have to drop a stock.
It feels so wrong as a Game & Watch to die that far off ledge because you get 100% recovery. And now we're off to the races, already getting some good percentage here. Pyra, again, look at just how, like, massive her hitboxes are.
Yeah, that's the thing.
That's just, like, that's a great ground, 54%. And now look at that, the up air combo. She can't really do anything here. Those up airs can just literally take her all the way to 84%. And I believe for Pyra and Mithra, that's a good percentage. And now we're going to see the Pyra come out. The side Bs are going to come out as well. Definitely. Oh. A little bit of 2 ships in the night there. That's a great percentage onto the Pyra. 51% on the Game & Watch. She's not doing great, but look at that. They don't know what to do against these up airs. Almost gets that up smash, and that's going to be a back air to almost send it. Oh, Game & Watch!
You hate to see that. He's got to be careful now because he's down to his last stock.
You can recover from that, by the way. Okay, there we go. We make it better, but you can recover from that as Game & Watch if you cancel it early enough with a double jump. You just probably didn't have his double jump ready yet. Oh no, what is that? Okay, now he's getting hit with a Mithra. The special move spam. Oh yeah, there's the up tilt. Like, look how massive that up tilt is compared to like Game & Watch's up tilt. Like, it just hits everything on the screen. And now we have Pyra, who does have insane kill potential. There's that down air, giving the spike, but... And that... The down air kills? What is that angle?
Yeah.
Wow, okay.
Yeah,
that killed.
Yeah, that misplay there was very costly for Cheshire, because he was doing so well.
It seems that Marietta is, like, allergic to being on stage. They really like to see what's in the blast zone. Choose your fighter. It's very unfortunate because, again, we have all of these chances to be able to do great, and we just accidentally just.
All right, so it looks like Ben Baker, Maker is going to be playing, and he's not on camera, but he's on the side there. But he's going to be bringing out the King DDD to be the anchor for this matchup.
So, playing King DDD, the problem with playing up against a Pyromithra is that he has such a large hitbox that any one of the special attacks that a Mithra is going to do or a Pyra is going to do is guaranteed to hit the DDD.
Well, I think he's going to have to keep his distance. I know he's been working on combos where he throws out the Goro, inhales it, and spits it back out. Mm-hmm. So I would expect him to use that quite a bit during this matchup. But yeah, he's a much slower character, so it's going to be hard to keep that distance from the Mithra.
The thing is, though, is that you can get some really nice like up air combos with him that lead into the pull in and the spit out off stage, and then you can really play mind games with the edge guard with DDDs able to hold his side smash that can kill you at around 60%. It's crazy how much you can do it, especially against a Pyromithra, who are a little bit more of a lightweight. Not a lightweight, but a lighter weight, I will say. Probably a midweight.
Let's see what stage they want to go with. This is going to be Hollow Bastion.
Hollow Bastion. That's a, it's all right stage. At least Pyromithra are down a stomp. So this is winnable for Ben.
But of course, there's still going to be a third person, even if Bremen wins. So he's got to make sure he doesn't drop a lot of stocks early on if they want to take this game. It is a best of three, but you still want to put yourself in good position in that last matchup.
Of course.
So Marietta is ready, so we're just waiting for St. Francis to be ready.
Yeah, they have to think a lot about that Pyromithra gameplay.
Ready? And everyone seems to be ready.
Yep, Pyromithra versus King DDD. We shall see. Pyron, gonna be SD, pops a save real quick. Now, here's the problem. So, here's actually the benefit of King DDD with it being such a small map, is that he's actually able to get his combos off a little easier than the Pyromithra. There's a dash attack, very punishable for King DDD. Okay.
Yeah, you gotta be careful with those up smashes because it's very predictable.
That's a nice down air, but again, punishable on landing. Okay. Doesn't quite get the Gordo back. Tries to do a side smash, doesn't quite get it. 62%, he's all the way up in the stratosphere, but the Pyra is just gonna sit down, not trying to contest him in the air. And now King DDD has to recover, and that's very punishable. Gonna get that down air.
Yeah, it's just, it's a very slow recovery.
Yeah, that's gonna be a stop taken away. 62% on this Pyromithra. Yeah, can't really get the hyper armor in time there, but you do get hyper armor on King DDD. It seems that USF are playing up against this very the Gordo combo you're talking about by just jumping up in the air. Well, that's a good Gordo. Really able to get that pressure in here. Oh, nice, a spit.
Oh!
What?
He's trying to go for a play there, but didn't quite get it.
Oh, you have to jump off the map. Okay, I see. He wanted to jump off the map, and then, but you have to be already in the air with that. You can't jump while doing that. So if you're already in the air, and he's done. Oh, that's another Pyromithra combo that just sent him off the stage. Again, I don't exactly know what Pyromithra does. All I know is that it looks very flashy. And here's Pyro. Again, oop. Good Gordo, but again, have to hit something other than a Gordo to kill. I think a Gordo kills at around like.
Oh, that's a huge hit there.
There we go.
But still gonna be very close. You see, he's down to his last stock.
That's good. Hit him while they're transforming. Again, the Gordo spam.
Yeah, I think he's just launching the Gordo too soon.
Oh, that star does get the stagger on him, but doesn't quite get the benefit of that. Again, really one of the best abilities of. pardon me, of DDD is his down tilt. It's very fast and very combo oriented. It combos in itself very well. I don't see a lot of down tilts being used. Nope, tries to go for that side smash, but the side B comes out, and that's doesn't kill because he's a heavyweight, but 148% anything will kill at this point. We're going to see the Pyromithra combo that they've been using coming out again, and that's going to be King Dedede sent back to Dedede's island. Pyromithra takes the W for the University of St. Francis. Again, those SDs early on really took a beating.
Yeah, that really was the difference there. I mean, two from Ginger Ale, and then the one from Cheshire. I mean, I think if it weren't for those, it could have been a different matchup there. I mean,
if you imagine without those SDs, we actually have more stocks than them in that final match. Because we saw that St. Francis didn't SD once. The only person that SD'd was us, Marietta. Mm-hmm. So if we don't SD a single time, we actually have 6 stocks compared to their 5 stocks. So we can win that very easily if you just don't SD. Right. So we just have to stay on stage.
Yep, so we'll see what kind of adjustments the team makes. It looks like for game 2, they're going to start off with Inava playing. So they're going to go over the map selections and decide what they want to go with. But we will see Inava leading off in game 2 here. So while we're waiting for that, we still got just a few more announcements to go over here. So I'm just going to go ahead and switch to that while we're waiting here. So, of course, we are always looking for more students for our program, whether you're a current Marietta College student or a high school student. We have our varsity titles in Fortnite, League of Legends, Overwatch 2, Rainbow Six Siege, Rocket League, Super Smash Bros., and Valorant. We do have our facility here. You've been seeing during the breaks and the pre-streams our facility. So we have several gaming machines. We do have several coaches for most of our titles, although we're always keeping an eye out for a coach for our Smash Brothers team. So if you or someone you know would like to work with us, the Smash team that you see here, please feel free to reach out to us. But we do have coaches for our other titles. We do try to help support our students on academics and mental health. We want to see them do well. And of course, there are scholarships available for high school seniors and college transfers. So for more information, you go to our Linktree, linktr.ee/MarittaEsports, which has links to all of our social media channels. So whether it's here on Twitch, Twitter, Facebook, YouTube, Instagram, we even have a TikTok. My elder millennial is still trying to figure out how to do it. So I need my students to help me figure out how to create TikTok content.
Don't look at me.
Well, I'm just saying in general.
Yeah.
But we also have links to try out for our scholarships, and you can even set up a Discord call to talk to our head coach. Now, speaking of tryouts, we do offer scholarships to be a part of our program. It is for incoming freshmen and college transfers. So we do have tryouts at least once a month, and sometimes we'll have in-person tryouts or online tryouts. So in the month of November, we'll actually have 2 tryout dates. On Saturday, November 11th, we will have in-person tryouts. If you are going to be on campus during the admissions open house, you can come check out our facility and try out while you're here. If you're not going to be visiting the campus on that Saturday, on Sunday, November 12th, we will be doing online tryouts through our Discord server. So you can see the links here. So you fill out the recruitment inquiry form at bit.ly/mcrecruit. You would schedule the trial at bit.ly/mcesporttryouts. And then join our Discord server at bit.ly/PyoDiscord. The QR codes for that are on your screen. And of course, if you're not available to try out in November, we do tryouts every single month. So we will have tryouts in December, January, February, and so forth. But just keep in mind, the longer you wait, it's probably a good idea to try out sooner than later. Just that way you can have your financial aid package available. So then you can make the most up-to-date decisions as far as where you'd like to go for college for esports. But all right, it looks like Marietta is just about, I mean, they are ready, so they're just waiting for St. Francis to hop in. So once they get started, we will get this game underway here.
Yeah, I really want to see Marietta just try and not SD this time. Like, well, it is so winnable if we just don't SD. Mm-hmm.
Well, we'll see. I mean, with Inava leading out, I mean, I know they've been working really hard and have been playing very well in some of the past matchups. So we'll see how this goes. So we're just still waiting for St. Francis to be ready, and then we will get things underway. We are still waiting, so appreciate everyone's patience while we wait for St. Francis to be good to go.
The second round, again, Marietta, I believe to deal with this Pyromithra after they get through the Roy, of course. I think actually starting the Min-Min is great against the Roy, because Roy doesn't have great range, and is also great against Pyromithra, because you're able to compete with their range. Mm-hmm. And we don't know the third person yet. We weren't able to quite see them.
Right, yeah. Min-Min is a really good zoner as well, which... especially if they land some of the combos, or especially that charged dragon punch can definitely be beneficial.
Definitely. Again, we're getting a little bit... Oh, there we go.
Okay, we're just waiting for them to say their go, and it's going to be the Roy starting off.
Marietta College, again, putting their Min-Min up against the Roy, this could be big for them. And again, Min-Min has a great recovery, so it's a little bit harder to SD.
Yeah, we'll see if Naiva on the Min-Min can take advantage of that
distance. Well, but she is on a smaller stage. The stage is not as big as Pokemon Stadium. Oh, Roy already got her up and out again. Yeah, you see, playing near ledge is never great for a character. Unless you're poking like Min-Min. So Min-Min, again, but they have to be aware that this stage is very difficult to keep their distance on.
Yeah, that's the thing. I don't know who chose the town and city, but...
100% already.
Yeah, but Roy is really good in close combat range.
This map is just really making it difficult for Min-Min. Oh, there's some good, that's some good damage. That's some good combos there. Oh, that's a good hit.
Okay. Roy was looking for the opportunity to strike.
Roy really does want to get in. Oh, that's a great punch. Min-Min taking the first stock, but at 147%, I believe Roy are gonna make it even very soon here. Oh, just able to dodge one of the attacks. It's like getting all Roy's off the stage. That's very dangerous for him if Min-Min's able to gimp him.
Still alive.
And kicking. Roy does recover. But again, he's off stage. Oh, not facing the right direction there. But Inaba, again, if Roy was to keep contesting off stage, Inaba can just absolutely roll him. Okay, and now it's even stock 2-2. But Roy's at 45% already. This could be Min-Min going aggressive early on. That's a great punch there. Again, keeping the good range does get in a little bit. Now when he has this big punch, Inaba. That's, just out of range. That there would have taken him off the stage and probably would have been another stock. But just out of the range there, as he's done with that parry. I meant counter. Ooh, that's very punishable on landing. Not a lot of frames for that. The jabs as well coming out. Trying to do a down B to try to catch. Yeah, that's not gonna work. Try to catch the Min-Min on ledge.
Yeah,
again,
so
not close enough again.
Boxes him in the air.
Inaba. Getting a little bit more aggressive than we usually see Inaba. Now has double dragons. Switches back to the curve. That's a great grab. That's a good back throw off the stage. Almost gets that. But that, it's very punishable. Again, when Roy's on the side of the stage, it's very good for Min-Min.
Nice combo there. Yeah, those dragon punches are going just a little too soon.
Oh, that's a great hit. And both are one shot at the moment. One good smash attack. Oh, that's a great hit for Inaba.
And that was huge!
And that's going to be another stock taken. 127.
You got to...
Okay.
You can celebrate, but
stocks
you gotta
even?
Be ready.
Stocks are even. Tactical reset. Gotta keep it even. I believe that she's just confident in her ability to take this stock, you know?
You're already getting the Roy to 75.
That's really good. That's kill potential already with all these dragon punches. Oh my, that's really good. This circle punch fist is very good for the distance keeping, honestly. It's very fast and hits in a very wide arc. Unlike the dragon punchers, it's a very linear angle. Ooh, that is so much damage taken.
Yeah, Roy hits so hard.
Roy just hit like two abilities and Anava's at 74%. But again, Roy is in kill potential and Anava sitting next to the off stage. Just get hit mid-air. That's gonna be her on stage. That was very close to being killed. A stock taken away from her. You can see her still keeping her distance, does the dragon punch instead of the loop, and that's gonna be Roy off stage. Again, not a great place he wants to be, but that's gonna be Anava getting hit with an aerial. Roy almost hits that jab. That jab would have killed him. 126%.
Oh, that's gonna be Min-Min with that side smash, taking it home. That's gonna be Marietta, first time in this series with a lead.
I mean, that was just so clutch back for it was dead even, but Inava closes it out at the very last second there. Oh, that is huge. That's exactly what the Pioneers need for that momentum.
Exactly. Now they're going to be able to take that stock into the next round. Again, Inava, all that she's going to be hoping to do is just get one kill there. If she gets one stock taken away from the enemy, then she's going to be able to just sit happy. She can lose her last stock after that if she's able to take one away, because that means that they keep that aggression and keep the what is it? Yeah, well, Brandon's thinking about it. They keep the advantage. There it is. They keep with that stock lead.
If they can just keep that, yeah. So if they don't close it, keep it even. But
can you tell I didn't have my coffee this morning?
What?
Can you tell I didn't have my coffee this morning?
you're good on that. But yeah, I mean, we'll have to see what St. Francis is going to go with, knowing they just got to take down one stock from Inava. But if Inava can. Yeah, like you said, if they can get at least one stock, if they can take one from this, then that will keep that differential. But we'll see. Sometimes with that momentum, they might be able to take a couple stocks, but we're just going to have to kind of play the waiting game here to see what map they're going to pick, and then we'll have to wait and see what character they want to go against this. But you can see everyone's just kind of like, okay, we can do this. I think they know that this is winnable.
Hashtag winnable, indeed. We're going to see that, again, Min-Min against Myra Pythra. Did I just say that?
I think.
Myra Pythra? Sure, we're going to go
Mythra,
with it.
I think that's how you pronounce it.
That sounds wrong pronouncing it, but we're going to go with it.
I'm pretty sure it's Pyra, not Pyra. I think it is Pyra.
Pyra, okay. Pyra Mythra.
Yeah.
There we go. That sounds Pyra Mythra. Sounds better.
Yeah, that's what you said the first time. You were right.
Okay.
You still, yeah, you definitely haven't had your coffee.
Okay, definitely not. Trying my best here. So, with that, I believe they're going to be able to go against that Pyra Mythra, against the Min-Min. Really, yeah. It's not in favor of anyone. I would say it's a very even matchup because they both have the same plan of wanting to be a little bit further back. I just think that Mythra has better combo potential than Min-Min. Min-Min's a very pokey character. That's kind of like a very linear thing that she does, just that she pokes and pokes and pokes.
But actually, we're going to see the Ness coming out.
Ness, on the other hand, that's going to be harder because Pyra has a lot of end lag on her abilities, which means that she is very susceptible to the Ness.
Well, I'm really interested about the Ness choice because, like for Min-Min, Min-Min doesn't have, like, a lot of spells, so, like, absorbing abilities isn't going to be as big of a deal.
Yeah, but the main game plan of Ness is as we see combos. And as we see is the PK fire. And again, because of the end lag of Pyromithra, we see it right there.
It's Min-Min, not Pyromithra.
I mean, sorry, Min-Min. The end lag of Min-Min makes it so that he has a very easy time going aggressive and getting this. And remember, 100% is kill percent for Ness's back throw.
I think what Ness is going to try to also aim for is keeping Min-Min in the air, because Min-Min doesn't really have good aerials. That's one of the biggest weaknesses.
Yeah, so you see on the ground, like, her abilities hit everywhere on the stage, but in the air, her abilities hit, like, right in front of her. That's about it. That's a good hit with that dragon punch. Ooh, that's really good shield pressure right there. Now they're going to be hit with a back air, 84%, 92% again. The combo to 100% almost gets him to, but that's going to be Min Min living there. Gets that grapple onto the stage, but that's going to be that's going to be the cheese of just holding it. So that's one of the only characters that can do that. If you just hold your down smash as Ness, the spinning yo-yo has a hitbox. So you can just hold it off stage or hold it right next to stage and you can't do it. You can't jump, you can't recover onto stage, you can't roll, you can't attack, you can't jump. You have to just take it. And if you're at 112%, you're dead. There's nothing you can do.
Alright, so we're gonna have Cheshire coming in. And it looks like they're gonna go with the Game & Watch again.
It's even at the moment. So this anything could happen here. And again, Inaba put up a great showing. Even against that Ness, she was actually putting up a great fight. Again, I believe it's that she just had one more stock. Or if she wasn't pushed off stage and had to grab ledge there, be a lot different there. Because the Ness missed his chance to actually get that 100% back throw kill. So after that, if Inaba was able to recover maybe on stage somehow and stop the mind game or stop the cheese of the yo-yo, she might have been able to actually win that because, again, she was able to poke out that Ness and Ness was having a really hard time approaching the Min Min.
Looks like it's going to be... I don't know if they're still locked in the small battlefield or not. I'm guessing not yet. They're still talking over what Marietta wants to play on.
Ness loves the three platforms. So yeah, going to a place with less platforms is going to be better. Because again, Ness can just... Well, if the more you let Ness combo you, the more chance he's just going to absolutely roll you. Yes. Because... again, Ness's game plan, get you to 100%, back throw you. That's his main goal as a character, and he's very one-dimensional in that fact. He just has multiple ways to get there. He can PK fire spam, he can hit you with, you know, smash attacks, he can use PK freeze, he can even, if he wants to, he can PK lightning.
Yeah, but keep in mind, with the Game & Watch, he has that bucket ability to absorb some of those attacks and spit it right back out. So I can see Cheshire trying to go for that bucket strat.
He definitely can be able to use his projectiles with that bucket to absorb it. And then after that, he's able to release it with a very powerful attack. But it's getting to that opportunity is going to be difficult when Ness, again, yes, they love using PK Fire, but also their aerials are just so good. And they have so many ways to get you into the air for the combos. Again, he has multi-hit attacks that I believe do like 10% each hit. So if you get hit by like three of them, you're already at like 30 or 40%. And that's like a small combo is three hits with Ness. And a PK Fire does around 15%. So you can get put to 50% instantly almost. Again, waiting patiently on USS. They're going to be staying with the Ness, of course. And the Game & Watch comes through. 6-6 at the moment with the stock battle. And again, Mr. Game & Watch and Ness are on even playing field with a 3v3. No one has the SD. They're going to be going straight at it. And again, these platforms are way worse for Ness comparatively. But look at that. Just like I was saying, they just went to combo you. There's that PK fire coming out. Bomb. 41% onto the Ness. He tries to go for a grab, but the Game & Watch is able to elude it. 45%, and there, that platform does make Ness, and that's why... There's no way. Okay.
Ooh, that was close.
He keyed off the map, but is able to catch him. Game & Watch moment. Almost. If he gets that down smash, I'm pretty sure that kills. Or at least that sends it off stage. Just PK flash. The PK fires. The Song of Ness, just PK fire. Good back air. 50% here. Ness is able to contest with that up air, of course. He gets back on stage. Bomba. There's that wall of damage you can't really contest. That's going to be 106% on the Game & Watch. He wants to go for the grab right there. You PK fire, you just hit the bat. And that's going to be Game & Watch down, like getting carried off stage with those side aerials. Game & Watch going to be able to get some good damage with that up air. But again, this Ness, it's just so much. 0% though on Digimon at the moment. Getting able to block those PK fires pretty well. There, Ness actually had the read that Genmon was gonna try to jump over the PK fire, so instead he went for the aerial instead. Oh, PK fire. He goes for those grabs a lot with the PK fire. That's gonna be making the stocks even, but 57% on the Game & Watch. This is not looking great for him because he uses that air dodge very high up on the stage. There's that back. Down smash, Game & Watch. Oh, does get that. Oh, 96%. He's super close. Now he's at kill percentage with the back throw. You see Game & Watch trying to elude the grab. Does get that nice turtle. Now he has to play so safe. If he gets hit by a PK fire or a grab, he's dead. Yep. Oh, he doesn't.
Dodges the baseball back.
Right there, because of the stun lock you have with the PK fire, you can just walk up and just bat the PK fire. So I'm very Game & Watch should be counting his lucky stars that Ness is actually misplaying here. But gets carried off the stage again by that side B. Side air. Not much you can do against that. And there's a PK fire. Yep. Look at that. Look at that. 45%. 3 PK fires. Love that character. Just so much. Bucket, yeah. Grabs, back throw. Not going to kill yet, because again, not at 100. And PK's fire off the stage. Almost gets spiked. That's the first PK Thunder they have to use in and that stuff.
Yeah, that's when the Cheshire will be taken out. I mean, it's just, yeah, like I said, spamming the PK fires, the aerial combos, and Game & Watch just did not really have an answer to that. Just didn't really have the recovery to dodge those once those combos were in the air.
That's why in like really high level play, you see Ness be played so often. Like, again, Ness has like 2 game plans. Actually around 3 game plans, but gets to them all the same. He wants to basically hit the bat after hitting the PK fire to kill you when you're at up about 100%. Back throw at 100%, or KO off the ledge at 100%. All just rely on you getting to 100%. But again, PK, Ness has so many good ways to do good percentage that it's so hard to contest him and so hard not to get into those very dangerous ranges. Especially as Game & Watch, when you're a lightweight, those percentages go down even further. Maybe like if you're a DDD, you have to go to like 110% before getting back through. Mm-hmm. But instead, let's see, we're also getting back through instead.
Just gonna do one thing here real quick. So we're gonna just swap over here for a second. Let's see here. Swap here for a second while we're waiting for.
Up!
I think for some reason when I accidentally pressed the button, we were muted. So all that commentary we just talked about was... I'm sorry.
I'd be like that.
Yeah.
Stream is a bit messed up. Thank you, Kilgore the Innkeeper. Yeah, we were muted.
Yeah, our apologies.
Smile. No cast point. Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you, Dwarf Star.
I'll just let him know.
Yeah, that's just unfortunate. That all that casting and all that talking about like how to counter Ness or how Ness interacts with a game. Yeah.
Okay, so let's just recap that a little bit there. So I mean, the main thing we were talking about is the PK fire, and like Ness does like can be vulnerable when casting like PK fire and PK cross. So if you can dodge it, you can get those hits. And we saw that even with the PK thunder, like it can hit really hard, but Ginger Ale was able to block some of that, dodge, dropped a couple stocks, but now down to our last stock, we're going to the last person for St. Francis. So Ginger Ale does have her work cut out because she can't drop a single stock if we want to go into game three.
Nope, she's going to have to 3-0 this person, so she's going to be really hoping for an easier matchup than against Ness. I mean, imagine a game where you go up against someone and all you play against is Ness 1, Ness 2, Ness 3.
Well, the thing is, for St. Francis, they have the advantages because they just got to drop one stock. So they just need to pick a character that can hard counter
Corrin.
Hard counter the Corrin. So we'll have to see what they're going to go with.
See, Corrin is really safe with her abilities, but again, she's very slow compared to other characters. Like, she has to, like, hit the ground with her spike, with her kick, and then go. And
we're gonna see the Joker coming out.
This is not what you wanted to see.
Yeah, like I said, they're trying to hard counter the Corrin to get that quick win. So we'll see if Ginger Ale can find an answer and take down three stock to go to game three.
We're gonna see it again. Ginger Ale, hoping to get rid of two of her stocks.
Here we go.
And Joker is very combo heavy, and Corrin is very slow, so it allows Joker to get all these combos off very easily. Yeah. 21% already. That dot damage really does take to a number over time.
That's good if the stun doesn't connect.
Joker actually only went off stage there, so this could be the pressure that Ginger Ale needs. 27%, that's gonna be a grab there. Tries to go into a combo, but it's gonna be Ginger Ale dodging it again. Here's the thing, if you're above Joker, he can just do up air after up air after up air and just get so much percentage. And you have to try to just predict it and air dodge it, but even then, he'll have to punish the air dodge with something else if he reads it. So you get that one predicts the other predicts the other, and you predict a prediction, and then you just have all that. And there's Arsene. And now he's actually going to be playing the game here. You basically just play Joker a little bit until you get Arsene. That's a great counter there. Going to be able to keep her in the game. 82% though. Only need one stock away. The Joker is going to be able to go down, but is going to be able to recover very easily here. That neutral B does do a number. And again, Ginger Ale at one shot territory. Arsene is gone, so that's going to be a little bit harder for Joker to pull off. Gets the jab. Does recover. Joker trying to get that counter, but doesn't quite get it.
Try to go for the stun there while in the air, doesn't quite connect.
Again, Ginger Ale needs to take the stock quick, or else she's going to take a one-way ticket home. Oh, it's so easy. Joker just holding it, and that's going to be an up smash to end it. Ginger Ale could not pull the 3-0 stock that she needed to get. And that's going to be Joker's bringing it home for St. Francis. GG's all around. That was actually a really close game, I would like to point out. Again, Marietta just had a very hard time going up against themselves, honestly, because really they just beat themselves the first round. They beat themselves with all those SDs. They just like had the jitters or something and were unable to just recover back onto stage.
Yeah. But yeah, so that'll be it for us today. So that's going to conclude the GLDC season for the fall. But there is still more Smash. So, in fact, next week, there will be two matches. So, on Wednesday at 7 o'clock, so we were supposed to play Fair State on Thursday. We had to get that rescheduled. So, the Smash Team will be back on Wednesday to play against Fair State. Smash Team will also have a match on Thursday. It's the same time as the Rainbow Six match. I'm going to try something to see if there's a way to cover that. So, I have some ideas for it. So, we'll see if there's a way to still go over that. So I'll have to talk with the team to see if there's a way we can arrange that. But there will be still some more Smash, at least for another week or two for the NACE season. So as a reminder, we do have our Fortnite match later today at 3. So we will take the stream down to give it a little bit of a break, but we'll be back up around 2:30 Eastern time. So hopefully you do join us for that. But for all the latest updates, what's called Marietta College Esports, please be sure to follow us here on Twitch, Twitter, Facebook, YouTube, Instagram, and TikTok. Shoutouts to all of our supporters, HyperX for being the official peripheral sponsor for Marietta College Esports. We also want to thank By Blue Light, Elgato. We want to thank Over the Moon Pizza, Incrediware, Kovacs, and MSI. Thank you all for watching. Thank you for your follows. Thank you for your subscriptions. Thank you for your gifts. And we hope to see you later this afternoon to cheer on the Fortnite team. So thank you for watching.